advanced care planning, in the way that it's been traditionally done, has been about patients basically thinking ahead in terms of what their future choices may be if they would be unable to speak to them directly. So these plans would only come into place when someone isn't able to speak for themselves. And in the U.S., there's been a long tradition around that version of advanced care planning. It wasn't tremendously successful. Most of us don't plan ahead well at any stage of life, but when it involves dying, it's even more difficult. And so the model really has moved to be more about empowering patients and enabling them to understand their choices, but also equipping healthcare providers within systems to actually listen to what they're saying and then implement care plans that actually match the goals and the values of the individuals in their care. I think it's especially important for those who are of a chronic illness and have some sense of what decisions they may be facing in care, to let the healthcare system clearly know and understand what treatments they may want or not want. And this goes both ways. It's about what you want as well as what you don't want. Dialysis, for instance, there are people who, you know, when told that they have kidney disease, know that they never want to have dialysis or that they never want to have a certain form of treatment. And so advanced care planning can allow them to plan ahead for who will speak for them if they can't, to say, these are treatments I am not prepared to consent to at any stage of my life ever, and to make these advanced statements about a durable intent to refuse, because so much of our healthcare system is dependent on people giving consent and being informed about what they're consenting to. And so this is a way of planning ahead, but also, more importantly, what we're finding, a way for patients to talk to family members about what's important. So beautiful examples are patients in some cultures where some of these things are never talked about. In fact, when advanced care planning is done well, it helps people to get in touch with what's really important in this season and to say things to people. Look after your mother. I love you. I appreciate you. Thank you for all that you've done for me. And to really embrace some of the opportunities that even end of life has for people in terms of personal growth and kind of closure of life tasks. There's lots and lots of tools available. You can go to the drugstore and buy a living will kit or something like that. But that by itself has not been shown to work. Just someone completing a form in isolation from their family members or in isolation from the medical decisions that might be relevant to their particular illness or whatever. So I think about it, reflect on it, be clear about what you'd like to do, and then engage in these discussions. Ask for help if the discussions are difficult. Some of the tools that are available online are like ebooks or tools that can help families walk through these difficult discussions in a way that's kind of structured and facilitated to be more comfortable. Talk to your family doctor, talk to anyone who's looking after you. Family doctors are being asked to do this at regular checkups with people, to just make it a normal part of care, is that I don't know what's best for you because I'm the doctor. I need to know what you would like to do, and then we can together construct a plan of care. It works best is if family is those to whom it matters, right? Those people who are going to visit your grave and attend your funeral, that, you know, and so the people that really are for whom this decision is important should be included in that decision making. And if we do that ahead of time, it often avoids the kind of conflicts that families can get into around end of life, where just because they don't want to accept what's happening, death is inevitable for all of us at some point, but it's still difficult. Make the time to do it, because often it's something that happens best if it's paced over time. So introduce the subject, and some follow-through, some opportunities to think about it, some opportunities to inform people about the decisions, and then to really have someone as your substitute decision maker who can then advocate with you within our systems of healthcare for the choices that you've made. The substitute decision maker is someone who helps to articulate within the context of the current health decision-making process what your goals, what would Dad say if he was here? So that's the person that you want to speak for you. Not now that Dad can't speak to you, I'm going to tell you what to do, and it's very different than what Dad wanted. So the role of the substitute decision maker is, if Jim was here, what would Jim be saying? and then to make sure that that's what happens. And so I think there's some confusion about that. And so that's to almost educate people about that role. It's really to be that spokesperson, not to insert your own story at that point. But it's difficult for families. It's one of the more difficult things in our culture to talk about dying. And so I think people may need support. So don't be afraid to ask for help with these decisions.